first things first, start off with what were your impressions of the Iron Bowl? You've seen quite a few of those, and this one, I don't know if it delivered the drama everyone was expecting, but there was certainly one just looked like a better football team than the other.
Yeah, I mean, Alabama lost a better team. I'm totally convinced of that. This is not some fluke kick six, which I'm not sure Alabama wins that game without the kick six because it would have gone to overtime. But there's nothing fluky about what happened. Alabama got beat. Alabama lost at the line of scrimmage on both sides of the ball. I think Alabama got out-coached, especially Alabama's defense, to be frank. When I look at what Auburn did and you know, what I've seen in replays, it confirmed what I saw live. You see a lot of plays where Auburn kind of creates space by, say, lining up two receivers on the right and sending them deep and then bringing a guy in motion or swinging a guy out of the backfield over to where the receivers had come from, and there's no defender there. So, you know, the swing pass or screen pass or even some of the quarterback runs like quarterback draw, it's just creating an open space and filling it with a guy with the ball. And that happened repeatedly. You look at the jump pass, he's got two options that are wide open there. He jumps up and there's a tight end in the end zone in front of him who he threw to, but there's also a guy that came in motion. And there's one defender on that side. Now, he can't cover them both. And in fact, he covered neither of them. But regardless, one of them was wide open. That's out coaching someone.
Did you think, and this is just me talking out loud, the whole part of the process to Nick Saban is to take it one game at a time, and it's been wildly successful, unparalleled success in that. But do you think that they place as much emphasis on the Iron Bowl as Auburn places on it?
No, I think there have certainly been more times than not in the last however many years where Alabama's just had so much talent that it didn't matter. But I honestly believe Auburn wants that game and probably needs that game more. I think there are more Auburn players and more Auburn coaches and more of the Auburn community that are geared up to beat Alabama than there are on the other side where Alabama wants to treat it like just another game. You know, it's part of the process. I think Nick Saban even maybe last week got asked about the emotional element of the game, and he kind of just downplayed it. You know, you don't want the emotions. You want an even keel all the time. Well, when the other team's up for you more than you're up for it, and there's enough equality of talent, I'll go with the emotional team. I think that's the one place that you could say Saban hasn't mastered every element of the psychological part of the game, when and how to push that button and get the superhuman effort out of your team. And I realize highs lead to lows and all that, but I mean, I remember Gene Stallings talking, and he was a pretty good football coach himself, about, you know, there's X number of times, maybe 2-3 times a year, when you can really get your team emotionally up. They cannot be that every week. And if you, you know, if you learn how to do that, I'm not quoting Stallings here, but I think if you learn how to press that button, how to get your team to come out with, you know, blood in their eyes and do what Auburn did. I thought Auburn played like they wanted the game more. I saw every guy on that team that had the ball in his hands try to get an extra inch every time. And I see things like Robert Foster, who's just kind of floundering around, not knowing where the first down marker is, and not playing like his life depends upon making that first down. And I'm not criticizing Jalen Hurts overall. Skip out of bounds when you could lower your shoulder and get an extra 3 yards. Auburn fought like it wanted to win, like it had to win, like it mattered. Alabama tried to play it as if it was another football game.
Tommy, what do you make of the passing offense? It's been such a hot button issue for Alabama fans, really going back to last year's playoffs and you know, the lack of progression from the passing game. And Nick Saban is very pointed when he said it's not just the quarterback, it's the offensive line being able to protect. It's the wide receivers to get open. And, of course, it also falls upon the quarterback to be able to go through his reads and make passes. Where do you think Jalen is after now essentially two seasons?
I think he's a better passer than he was a year ago at this time. I don't think he's an elite passer. I have seen times where he has gone through the progression and made the reads, but that mostly is when he's had time. He does keep his eyes downfield better than he did last year. and doesn't pull it and go down and pull it and run as soon as he did last year. But I'll be frank, I'm not impressed with Alabama's overall scheme and identity on offense. I don't think it looks like a democracy to me. And I hate to compare everything to Lane Kiffin, but whether you liked Lane or you didn't, Lane very quickly and definitively identified who his playmakers were and said they're going to get the ball. And I see Alabama reacting, I think, to last year when all the backs were beat up at the end and say, we're not going to give a back too big a load. So everybody gets six carries. The democracy. And you got Calvin Ridley, who's probably the best wide receiver in the country, and you're going to throw it to him five times a game, but you got to throw it to the other guys. No, you don't. You have to throw it to the guys who can make the plays. Look at Amari. You know, he had 15 and 18 targets in games. I think if Alabama had come into the Auburn game, I mean, every time they threw deep to Calvin, he, you know, either caught the ball or he got interfered with it and he dropped one. I would have wanted to take five more shots. It'd be 15 yards a pop, probably, if they interfere with you and if in more if you catch it. I would like to have seen them recognize what I thought I recognized, which is Damian Harris had the hot hand. He's the one guy on that team that played like the Auburn guys were playing, like it meant more than anything in the world to him. He was going to get every inch he could. And he gets the ball on a series a few times, and then you don't see him for almost a quarter. I just don't understand what they're trying to do on offense, and I don't think they have looked at it and said, here's the players who can make plays. Everybody else take a back seat. We're not here to make everybody happy. If you want to get on the field, then you work harder in practice and earn that spot.
Tommy, as it stands right now, you know, we still got conference championship games to play this weekend. But from what your read of what you've seen from the committee now through 4 or 5 weeks, where do you think Alabama's chances are of making this playoff? And what really in your mind needs to happen for them to have a legitimate shot?
I think the biggest thing would be TCU beating Oklahoma. I think and if that happens, Alabama's in. If Ohio State also beats Wisconsin, then Alabama's in. But if Oklahoma wins and Ohio State beats Wisconsin, then it's a coin flip. And I think I would pick Alabama, but I wouldn't pick them mainly because of one less loss in the Iowa game for Ohio State. But I wouldn't pick it with a lot of confidence because I'm not 100% sure Alabama's one of the best four teams. And you know what? If Oklahoma wins and Wisconsin wins, and then whoever wins the SEC championship and whoever wins the ACC championship, if that's the four, I don't think Alabama has a good argument that it should displace any of those teams. Alabama would have needed to beat Auburn. You know, even if you lost the SEC championship game, a win over Auburn would have been a win over a top-five type team. And Alabama doesn't have the one win. You know, what are you hanging your resume on? You beat LSU, which lost to Troy. You beat Fresno State, really? You know, they've done good. All credit to Fresno State. If that's one of the things that you're one of the places you're trying to plant your flag, then I'm not sure about that.
So let's say play the scenario out. You think if let's say Ohio State beats Wisconsin, you're then left with a one loss Wisconsin team that didn't win the championship, Big Ten championship. You got a two loss Ohio State team who's got a 30-point loss to Iowa, a 15-point loss to Oklahoma. Would you think the committee would put in Ohio State with two losses simply because of the conference championship element?
Yeah, and I think that's a fair argument to make. I understand the differential in losses. I would also think that Ohio State would have a better win than Alabama has, and maybe a couple of them if you look at the schedule. I'm not sure, but one of them for sure, because Alabama hadn't beat a team as good as Wisconsin. And they would have a conference championship, and Alabama's not even a division champion. So, yeah, I think they would in that case. If that's the only – it would be an interesting debate, but if that's the only thing that happens in Alabama's favor, just if Oklahoma wins and the other two games don't matter, the winner of the ACC and SEC championship game is in. I don't think the loser's in either case, in my opinion. That would be my best guess. So it really comes down to Ohio State against Wisconsin and Oklahoma against TCU. And if Ohio State wins, it's an interesting debate, and we'll see where it falls. But if Oklahoma also wins, I kind of think Alabama might be on the outside looking in.
Talking to Tommy Dees, executive sports editor for the Tuscaloosa News. Do you think what scenario is best for Alabama, Georgia or Auburn victory on Saturday?
I think that's a wash. I don't think either of them helps Alabama. I guess the Auburn winning would probably be better because Alabama lost to them. That would be a better loss, but I think it was already a good loss as far as, you know, they lost to a good opponent. No loss is good, don't get me wrong. But when evaluating, I guess Auburn is probably the team that would benefit Alabama the most, but I'm not sure it matters that much.
Tommy, we've reported Jeremy Pruitt has interviewed with Mississippi State. His name has come up in connection with both the Mississippi State and the Tennessee jobs. We've seen, I think, three defensive coordinators at Alabama under Saban. Was Kevin Steele, and then Kirby was there for a long time, and now Jeremy's been there for 2 years. Do you get the sense that Tosh Lapoy is the guy? Is he ready? And if not, some of these Nick Saban hires have been out of the box, but all of those have primarily been offensive hires. Do we have any idea what Nick Saban would look for? I mean, even when Jeremy left, all the talk when Kirby would be up for a job is, well, Jeremy would come back because Saban thought so much of Pruitt. I don't know that we get a sense now. I know they're grooming Tosh to be a defensive coordinator, but I don't know if they think he's ready yet.
You know, I don't know enough about how he's regarded in the building as far as that goes, as far as readiness. I tend to think, you know, what Nick Saban did was groomed Kirby Smart to be his coordinator, and then he groomed Jeremy to be it. And I remember hearing that like early on when Jeremy had only been like a position coach for a year or whatever, I was hearing, oh, he'll be Alabama's next defensive coordinator. And I was kind of like, really? What's he ever done? But even before he was a coach, I think on the field coach, he was being groomed for that. And it's worked out pretty well, I think. I would say if Nick Saban's grooming somebody for that, then Nick Saban will probably put him in that position. Otherwise, I don't know exactly. There's a lot of guys out there who've worked that Saban system and know it well enough that are coaching at various places that he wouldn't have trouble finding one who does things the way that he wants. I think it's possible that we see Nick Saban kind of buckle down where he takes an even more hands-on role in the defense. I remember early in Kirby's tenure as defensive coordinator, there were a lot of times when you would see Saban in the defensive huddle during a game, you know, if they call it timeout or whatever. And then there came a point where Nick Saban wasn't in that huddle. It was Kirby's huddle. You may see whoever's next, if Jeremy Pruitt were to leave for a head coaching job or otherwise, which I don't think he'd leave otherwise, but you may see Nick Saban being that guy in that huddle a little more often as he breaks in the new guy.